First of all, a very warm welcome to everyone. My name is Claudia Bodinek and I am currently working for the company Röbbig Munich. I curated the special exhibition together with my colleague Dorota Gabrisch. Ladies and gentlemen, since May the 24th to September the 29th, the Wawel has been showing the exhibition Magnificence of Rococo, Kendler's Meissen Porcelain Figures, which took place in the Wawel Column Hall. It provided a comprehensive overview of the work of Johann Joachim Kendler, probably the most famous master modeler of the Saxon porcelain manufactory in Meissen. But one subject area was intentionally left out, which I would like to focus on in my presentation today, the figurative tableware. The Wawel website contains detailed information about Kendler. Therefore, let me recall only the most important events of his life here. Augustus the Strong, King of Poland and Elector of Saxony until 1733, recognized Kendler's talents and appointed him court sculptor in 1731 at the age of 25. In the same year, Kendler began working at the Meissen Porcelain Manufactory, initially under his colleague Johann Gottlieb Kirchner. When Kirchner left the manufactory in 1733, Kendler was promoted to master modeler. His early years were centered around the royal dream of a porcelain palace. Augustus the Strong planned not only to present his extensive collection in the so-called Japanese Palace in Dresden, but also to showcase the skills of the Meissen manufactory that he himself had founded, possibly even in deliberate comparison with the East Asian products that reached Europe via long-distance trade from China and Japan. For example, there were to be rooms dedicated to the ground colors, which showed the rich palette of paints available to his manufactory. Furthermore, an animal gallery with largely life-size porcelain figures was planned, as well as a chapel, which was to be furnished with figures of saints in porcelain. Kendler managed to get a feeling for the porcelain material, which was not easy to work with. Especially during firing, it was not unlikely that the rather large models would become deformed or cracked. Until 1735, Kendler mainly produced figures of animals and saints. At the same time, he followed the widespread Chinese fashion by producing mostly smaller Chinese figures, which were called pagods. However, the new King Augustus III didn't pursue the project of a porcelain palace with the same intensity as his father. So Kendler was able to turn his attention to other tasks. Once the orders for the Japanese palace, placed by Augustus the Strong, had been completed. In 1735, he was joined by Johann Friedrich Eberlein. As far as can be deduced from the sources, Eberlein didn't develop any particular ambition, but he created many remarkable objects under Kendler's direction in the following years, until his early death in 1749. Above all, this gave Kendler the option to explore new sales opportunities. At the end of 1736, the first so-called crinoline group was created, or rather gallant group, which Kendler describes as follows in his work report from December. A group consisting of two figures, made for the storehouse, showing a well-dressed young man sitting on a green lawn and embracing a woman dressed in a sackback gown. It is clear from his words that the group was not a commissioned work, but that he made it on the off chance, so to speak, to gauge the response of his aristocratic clientele. Looking back, we can summarize that Kendler's attempt was a great success for the manufactory. Other gallant groups soon emerged, always depicting members of the nobility engaged in pleasurable, often amorous activities, thus representing their everyday lives on the one hand and expressing their secret desires on the other. This success was most likely favored by the Recueil Julien, published in 1735, with the works of the French painter Antoine Watteau, the creator of the Fête Galante, which depicted aristocrats free from courtly constraints, enjoying themselves in the countryside, thus portraying their longings. Under the new King Augustus III, two people gained increasing influence at court: Alexander Joseph Sulkowski and Heinrich Count von Brühl. They soon became the de facto administrators of the Saxon-Polish Union, as the king himself showed little ambition to get involved in day-to-day politics. Brühl also took over the management of the Meissen manufactory, while Sulkowski was responsible for the deliveries to the Japanese palace. Sulkowski took advantage of his position and ordered a magnificent dinner service from the manufactory in 1735, which ultimately comprised more than 650 tableware pieces. What we take for granted today was still the exception at that time, as the first real porcelain services were not produced until around 1730 and were destined for the king. Sulkowski was therefore the first to receive a porcelain dinner service apart from the king. On Sulkowski's instructions, Kendler modeled the forms after the gilt silver service that Augustus the Strong had made in 1719 for the wedding of his son, the later King Augustus III. This applies to the lemon basket as the centerpiece, as well as to the tureens. The lion with the coat of arms and the female protomes as handles can also be found on a gilded silver tureen made before 1730, which was formerly in the Dresden Court silver collection. There was probably also a model in precious metal for the table candelabrum. A female figure, whose sandals are reminiscent of ancient mythology, has sat down on a stool and is holding a vegetable stem that branches out into four arms, on which the spouts for the candles are attached. The fifth candelabrum arm rests on her head. However, the true speciality of the Sulkowski service is the border, the Sulkowski osier relief, an interlaced pattern divided into 12 compartments, which covers the ledge or border of the plates and dishes, for example. The earliest entry on the Sulkowski service in the modeler's work reports dates from September 1735, when Kendler writes, "A 12-lobed soup plate woven around the border as a basket." Once again, in December of the same year, Kendler himself worked on the flatware, which includes the plates, bowls, and dishes, and created four dishes of different sizes, before Eberlein took over this part of the work in January 1736, while Kendler concentrated entirely on the more elaborate forms. The tureens, the candelabra, and, last but not least, the centerpiece, consisting of a lemon basket on a stand, surrounded by vessels for vinegar, oil, mustard, and sugar. As can be seen from Kendler's work reports, the Sulkowski service was repeatedly supplemented until the autumn of 1737. Even before its completion, the manufactory was commissioned by Count Brühl to design a new dinner service for which Kendler produced the first sample plate in April 1736. However, work only began at full speed in January 1738, a month before Sulkowski had to retire. Why he fell out of favor with the king is a subject of much speculation to this day. It may have been his fault that he declared his service as a delivery to the Japanese palace and thus transferred the costs to the king. This approach was not quite as brazen as it might appear at first glance, because Sulkowski was a cabinet minister and represented the Saxon-Polish Union on behalf of the king. His colleague Brühl acted with more diplomatic skill by initially bearing the costs himself and leaving it to the king's goodwill to free him, which Augustus III ultimately did. The new service that Kendler and his colleague Eberlein created for Count Brühl up to 1743 set new standards in every respect and at the same time impressively demonstrated the manufactory's craftsmanship and design skills. We are talking about the world-famous Swan service, which is still one of the Meissen manufactory's bestsellers today. What exactly prompted Kendler to take an unconventional approach to the new service for the Count can only be surmised today. It is very likely that the Sulkowski service, which Kendler modeled directly after a silver service, was a decisive factor. This example had shown him that it was perfectly possible to imitate precious metal vessels with their elaborate decoration in porcelain. The new service for Count Brühl was now to go far beyond mere copying and demonstrated the creative potential of porcelain as a material. At the same time, Kendler established porcelain services in competition with the dominant services made of silver and gold. A new feature of the porcelain was the relief interior of the plates, bowls and dishes, in short, the flatware, which depicts two majestic swans swimming on a reedy water surface, a heron with a fish in its beak and another in the air complete the setting. In contrast, the painted decoration is limited entirely to the ledge and consists solely of the Brühl coat of arms and in few scattered flowers. Kendler thus broke with tradition, as the well was usually decorated with a painting, such as the coat of arms on the coronation service and the Sulkowski service, while the relief decoration only covered the ledge. The freestanding sculptural figures and groups that dominate the decoration of the tureens, candelabra and centerpiece are also spectacular. The design element is not new in itself, as Kendler's predecessor Kirchner had already created a goblet around 1727, the lid of which is crowned by two figures from ancient mythology, to mention just one example. Kendler also orientated himself on mythology, especially sea creatures such as the nymphs and the fish-tailed tritons. A set of three tureens of different sizes, begun in July 1738, was dedicated to the story of the Nereid Galatea, a daughter of the sea god Nereus. Polyphemus, the one-eyed cyclops, known from Homer's Odyssey, fell in love with the beautiful Nereid, who, however, found more favor with the shepherd boy Arcas. Jealous, Polyphemus killed his rival, but Galatea managed to turn his blood into a river so that she could be close to him. The most common form of the story goes back to the Metamorphoses by the Roman poet Ovid, who lived between 43 BC and 17 AD. The Metamorphoses exerted a not inconsiderable influence on the visual arts in the Middle Ages and the Baroque period, which is why the story of Galatea was often depicted in painting. Here is a picture by Raphael from 1512 showing the Nereid in a shell chariot drawn by dolphins. The cupids flying above her indicate her love affair. Claude Lorrain presented the myth in a completely different way in 1657. Here, the intimate love between Acis and Galatea takes center stage, shielded by a blanket, while the jealous Cyclops observes the events from the mountainside. Kendler dispensed entirely with the tragic element of the story and portrayed Galatea riding a dolphin in the presence of a nymph and a cupid. The garment billowing in the wind symbolizes the movement and also practically serves as a handle for the lid. The smallest of the three terrenes shows a similar structure, except here Galatea is accompanied by the shepherd boy Acis. Galatea is probably also the protagonist of the center terrene, and not the goddess of love Venus, as is sometimes claimed in literature. The Nereid sits in a shell chariot drawn by two swans gliding over waves. The depiction also includes a pair of tritons pushing the chariot and a cupid riding on one of the two swans. To emphasize the unity of the three terrenes, Kendler designed the handles as tritons as a special detail. With two triton women on the largest, male tritons on the middle one, and triton children on the smallest. These three terrenes in multiple copies formed the center axis of the table. The highlight was a centerpiece or plate-ménage. The term plate-ménage is still used today in some regions, such as Switzerland, to describe a condiment stand. And strictly speaking, the Baroque plate-ménage was nothing more than an opulently decorated condiment stand, grouped around a raised lemon basket, which could either stand on feet or a special stand, with additional small jugs for vinegar, oil and mustard, as well as a sugar bowl. Only the base and individual containers from the plate-ménage of the Swan Service have survived. The lemon basket in particular must be regarded as a war loss. However, there's a watercolor from 1900 that corresponds with Kendler's own description from September 1738. According to this, the figurative decoration consisted of a triton and a siren holding the shield with the coat of arms on the lemon basket. The basket itself rested on two kinds of feet. Quote, "One consists of two intertwined dolphins, but the other represents a shrub reed on which a swan sits, on which a child rides." End of quote. The vinegar and oil jugs that Kendler made in December 1738 also show a similar motif. Quote, "A little jug of vinegar and oil in the shape of a swan, with a triton child sitting on it, with a drawn-out rope that gives off the handle." End of quote. After the mustard jug, again in the shape of a swan, the sugar caster was created in February 17:39. Quote, "There are two swans on the same sugar bowl which stand in the reed and carry a shell, on top of which is a lid with a screw, also in the shape of a snail." End of quote. While Kendler only personally undertook the tureens, the plaque ménage, and the candelabra for the Sulkowski service, and left the rest, especially the flatware, to his assistant Eberlein, it is striking that he produced all the models for the swan service himself. It was only in the second half of 1739 that Eberlein was also involved, listing a candlestick and a four-armed candelabrum, which Kendler had already commenced, in his work report of September 1739. A young man holds on to a reed stalk that forms the shaft of the candelabrum, while bending down lovingly towards a female triton that appears to have just emerged from the sea. It is unlikely to be Acis and Galatea, as Galatea was a nymph, but the theme has been suitably varied, so Kendler can be assumed to be the author of the figures. Johann Gottlieb Eder, who joined the Kendler-Eberlein team in 1739, created a further tureen for the swan service in November 1742, which, with the nymph on the lid and the triton women as handles, echoes Kendler's examples, but is considerably simpler in design. All in all, the swan service ultimately comprised well over 2,000 individual pieces of tableware, a number that was rarely reached in the history of the manufactory. Kendler had to keep renewing the molds because they were used so often that they soon wore out. Surprisingly, Kendler took care of the repairs himself and didn't leave them to his colleagues Eberlein and Eder. The importance he attached to the service is also evidenced by a note from his own pen. Quote, "As we would have special reason to make something nice for the great minister, as he is very well versed in art, and many foreigners came to such a great gentleman who judge about it. This would certainly lead to the greatest recommendation in foreign countries, if such a service were properly made, as other courts could be made to yearn for it." End of quote. In a way, Kendler thus answers the question of what prompted him to create such a service that broke with tradition. In fact, it served to demonstrate the artisanal and artistic possibilities offered by porcelain, which was still a relatively new material, and at the same time showcased the manufactory's high level of expertise. And Brühl was exactly the right person for several reasons. He was the director of the manufactory and, like Kendler, interested in exploiting new markets in order to increase sales. Moreover, he was, especially after Sulkowski's dismissal, the actual representative of the state, the center of the court, where the Saxon-Polish nobility came and high-ranking foreign guests were welcomed. Brühl was also considered to be well-versed in the arts. In this context, one may wonder whether the swan service was actually in practical use and not just a display service, which was presented to guests on a separate sideboard to arouse their desires. The long production period of over 5 years rather points in this direction, as Brühl had no need to entertain his guests on a half-finished service. Furthermore, at that time, in the 1730s and 1740s, services made of precious metals were still highly valued. In his will, Brühl stipulated that his silver service should be part of his inalienable majorate inheritance, which always passed to his eldest son. Only his son Alois Friedrich, who died in 1793, also included the swan service. Strangely enough, the swan service of all things is missing from Brühl's estate inventory, which was compiled after his death in 1763 at the instigation of the new elector Christian Friedrich, who alleged that Brühl had enriched himself at the expense of the state, an accusation that was soon to prove unfounded. As a result, also we know exactly how many pieces of tableware Brühl's other services comprised. The extent of the swan service remains purely speculative to this day. In any case, it remained in the possession of the family, who lived at Pfertin Castle, now Brody, in Poland, until 1945. It was a capture by the Red Army that led to the destruction of a large part of the service, including the above-mentioned Plattmenage. It is mainly thanks to Karl Berling, the former director of the Dresden Museum of Decorative Arts, that some of the items have been preserved for later generations. Partly due to loans from the Brühl family to the Dresden collections, and partly due to the early photographs and drawings that Berling published in his works on Meissen porcelain. The swan service can be regarded as the culmination of Baroque splendor, which was to remain unparalleled but provided numerous ideas for later services. As early as 1742, when the swan service had not yet been completed, Brühl ordered another service, the size of which can be estimated at 2,118 pieces of tableware based on contemporary sources, the so-called Brühlsches Allerlei. A comparison of the two services reveals the change in taste, which now favored the playful Rococo style, but also the transformations that had taken place in the manufactory around 1740, which gave new impetus to the painted decoration. The sculptural element was now limited to rocaille, and especially the border, which consisted of 6 different patterns. Field crops, fruit such as a lemon, an artichoke, a cauliflower plant, a kohlrabi, or a celery tuber were only used as lid knobs and handles. Eberlein was responsible for the sculptural design of the new service. Kendler was essentially only involved in the Plattmenage and designed the largest of the tureens, without any figurative decoration. Production continued until 1747. The special feature of the swan service, the sculpturally decorated well of the plates, bowls and dishes, was only taken up once more, namely by Eberlein for the so-called Gotzkowski relief decoration. Johann Ernst Gotzkowski was a Berlin entrepreneur who traded in objets d'art and handicrafts, among other things, partly on behalf of the Prussian King Frederick the Great. In 1761, he founded his own porcelain manufactory, from which the Königliche Porzellanmanufaktur Berlin, or KPM, emerged 2 years later. Eberlein describes the new decoration in February 1741, when it first appeared, as follows. A bowl mold, which is lobed, on its base a wreath of flowers, not less on the latch 4 shields, together with 4 flower bouquets, the outermost edge of which is pierced, and all very painstakingly worked. End of quote. In what follows, he only briefly mentions the flower design, and it is not until June that the reader learns that the tableware is intended for Monsieur Gostkowski. However, Gostkowski only served as an intermediary, primarily for the Russian market. Numerous pieces of tableware with the Gostkowski relief can be found today in the State Hermitage in St. Petersburg and can be divided into two services according to their painted decoration, which were created in 1741 and 1744 and are now known as Elizabeth Service 1 and 2. However, it is doubtful whether Tsarina Elizabeth was actually the recipient, as she was still complaining in Saxony in 1744 that she didn't own a service made of mice and porcelain. Augustus III didn't take long to agree. The new service was again based on the Gostkowski relief decoration, now adorned with the Russian double-headed eagle and St. Andrew's cross in painting. It is noteworthy that the Gostkowski series also includes tureens and a plat menage with sculpted figures. It almost seems as if Eberlein wanted to emulate his master. In addition to the handles in the shape of women, Eberlein mentions in June 1741, as sitting Apollo to only the aforementioned tureen, playing on the harp, together with three children, the first of which is presented with a flute, the second with a lute, and the third with a music book. Just 1 month later, another figure decoration followed. Quote, a figure of Pallas, seated, leaning on her shield, together with five children representing various arts, and belonging to the tureen with flower design to Monsieur Gostkowski. End of quote. Both versions of the tureen have survived and confirm Eberlein's descriptions down to the last detail. However, the original plat menage, the centerpiece of which Eberlein worked on from April to August 1742, depicting Mount Parnassus with Apollo and the nine muses, has not survived. To give you an impression, I show you a later version that Kendler made around 1762. The winged horse Pegasus was also part of Eberlein's version. The two services for Count Brühl and the Gostkowski relief decoration mentioned above can be traced fairly precisely in their genesis on the basis of the modeler's work reports. However, this was to remain the exception, as many services were composed of molds that the manufactory already had in stock. The three Russian services with the Gostkowski decoration should be remembered here. Another service, for which Kendler and Eberlein had to make completely new molds in 1741-42, was intended for the Elector of Cologne, Clemens August. The sculptural decoration was limited to Cupids pouring baskets of flowers onto the tureens. It is particularly noteworthy that Kendler himself wrote in his work report of July 1742 that the sauce boat he had just completed for the electoral Cologne service could also be used for the order of the Prussian minister Heinrich von Podewils. In fact, almost all the molds for the Podewils service were recycled from the Clemens August service. A A similar case concerns the stand of the lemon basket belonging to the Plat Ménage of the circa 1747 service for the English ambassador Sir Charles Henbury Williams, which Eberlein had already modelled in 1745 for the manufactory commissioner Karl von Nimptsch, describing it with the words, a Plat Ménage consisting of a palm tree, female Moor, and monkey, for His Excellency the Chamberlain von Nimptsch. To summarize, Kendler Swan Service in no way triggered a particular demand for figurative porcelain services, presumably for very practical reasons. Since who could afford such an elaborate service? Only the Gotzkowski relief decoration can be seen in the tradition of the Swan Service. However, it is worth asking whether it would have been in the interests of Kendler and his assistants to produce further services of this kind, which took several years to produce. For comparison, Swan Service 1738-1743, Brühl's Allerlei 1742-1747, and the Gotzkowski Dekor 1741-1744. The future of the manufactory rather lay in its wide range of products. Not every service, not every sculpture had to be unique. Nevertheless, Kendler Swan Service probably succeeded in impressively demonstrating the manufactory's high artistic and technical potential in the field of porcelain sculpture. In fact, there was a certain amount of catching up to do in this sector, as Kendler's colleague and competitor Johann Gregorius Hörold dominated the 1720s with his painting decoration. To conclude our tour of the Meissen porcelain services of the 1730s and 1740s, I would like to introduce you to a Plat Ménage that Kendler designed for Count Brühl in 1737, the year before the serial production of the Swan Service began. The subject of the depiction is not the Greek mythology, which was decisive for the later examples, but the widespread Chinese fashion. All the human figures are characterized by their physiognomy and their garments as Asians, also their designation in the manufactory records of the same time varies between Japanese and Indian, what means East Asian. Kendler also used both terms synonymously in his work reports. The fascination with the exotic countries of the Far East was based on the one hand on illustrated travelogues, which came onto the book market shortly after the middle of the 17th century, and on the other hand, on the products that the Dutch East India Company in particular brought to Europe in long-distance trade, where they were highly valued as luxury goods, especially tea and porcelain. In the 1720s and early 1730s, in particular, the manufactory produced numerous seated Chinese figures, which were called pagodas. By the time Kendler created the Japanese Plat Ménage, the Chinese fashion had already passed its peak and only played a subordinate role in Meissen before a completely different view of Asians became established from the middle of the century. The exhibition Magnificence of Rococo offered numerous examples of this. These circumstances are probably the reason why Kendler's Japanese Plat Ménage remained unique. According to his work reports, Kendler first produced sketches in June 1737, which were probably well received, so that he was able to finalize the Plat Ménage in August and September. as a special feature. Kendler figuratively molded each vessel for the plate-ménage. The vinegar and oil jars each depict a cock rider whose hat serves as a lid, while the cock's tail is used as a handle. An Asian woman riding sideways on a hen carries the mustard barrel with its characteristic recess into which the spoon was hung. Two Indian figures of both sexes who love each other, as Kendler aptly describes, form the body of the sugar caster, whose screwed-on lid looks like a canopy. Two shell-shaped, closable tins were available for other species, each with a smiling Asian woman sitting behind it. The narrow sides of the lemon basket are both formed as a cock's head, which is also intended as a handle. Another Indian couple sits on the display sides. It is noteworthy that no matching service was provided for this plate-ménage. It was presumably combined with another service, of which Brühl had no shortage, or only served as a showpiece. With this, Kendler had already demonstrated the possibilities offered by porcelain as a material before the swan service was begun.